Right, Michael, can you tell us something about your days as a youth in Jamaica, growing up?
Oh, boy. That is a hard, it's a long story, but, you know, as a youth growing up in Jamaica, you know, we passed through a lot of tribulation, you know, struggle here, struggle there, you know what I'm saying? But we always keep a keen, head, you know what I'm saying? Because I know there is a future out there and, you know, There's a time when things gonna be happening, you know what I'm saying? So as a youth boy,
Because you were a boxer, weren't you?
Yeah, sort of. Yeah, I was kind of like, you know, I used to enjoy doing that, like even playing cricket too, football and things, but I used to enjoy the boxing thing. And then, boy, I take off to something else, you know what I'm saying? You know, like doing my singing, that's where it start off now, yeah.
So when did you first realize that you wanted to be a singer?
Well, from first, it's in the mind, it's in the mind, it's in the brain, it's in the whole body, but it's when it was got ready to come out, you know what I'm saying? So, like, it's when I was about, like, 25, 23, then I really realized that I can head for the big time, you know what I'm saying? My future is where it lies, yeah.
Because what particular artists influenced you? Because you're a singer who's got a very distinctive style. There's nobody who's gone before you in the 70s.
Right.
Who you've based yourself on directly. So what particular artists do you think have influenced you?
So when I was a youth, I used to listen like to Al Baba and the Alton Ellis.
Yeah.
And Bob Marley too. But it's like my favorite artist was like Dennis Brown, growing up, you know what I'm saying? And then, but my secret admirer was Bob Andy, really. He's a man, he's straightforward in his singing. And
great songwriter.
Yeah, I always admire his talent.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was very good.
Were you singing on sounds? Did you come up through
that way? Yeah, well, I come up through like sound system, dancehall business, you know. I sing on a few sounds. Magnum Force, that was our first sounds. Then you got Echo Vibration. Then you got Stereograph coming down the line to Stereo Mars. I used to do a whole lot of, you know, in the surrounding, you know what I'm saying? Like every Friday night, Saturday night, anywhere the sounds play, you know, we end up there doing all the good things. Yeah, and that's where it starts from, really.
Yeah. So how did you first get your break? Because was it Yabby?
Yeah, but my first break was, I used to go to like different type of producers like Joe Gibbs and all them people, even Bunny Lee and all them people, even Channel One, you know, Hernis and all them and man, and it's like they never really interested, you know what I'm saying? I remember I go to Joe Gibbs one time and he said, boy, the song that I was singing was Praise You, Jaja, that I'd done for Yabiyo. Yeah. And he was saying, boy, I sound a bit like Dennis Brown. So, you know, I have to, you know, they can't bother with me, you know what I'm saying? Well, while walking away to myself, I said, well, boy, God damn it, man, if I sound like Dennis Brown, I must be good, man. I must be kicking. So,
how old were you then?
I was about, like, 23 them times, 23, 24, growing up, yeah? And then, eventually, one day, I went to Channel One day, before I even went to Channel One, I was up and down the place, man, saying, listen, man, what am I going to do, you know what I'm saying? I go into King Tubby's and, you know, like they wasn't interested, but one day I go to Channel One and Yabiyo was there, and someone tell me about this Yabiyo, right? I said, well, then, boy, I have to meet him. So I begged Zebby to let me in Channel One to see Yabiyo. When I went in, there was Wayne Wade, Patrick Andy, and Yabiyo, and Trinity, and all them people. And I quietly asked him, you Yabiyo? He said, yes. I said, well, then, boy, I'm a young artist, and I would like you to, you know, get me going out there, And at the back, he take me to the room, to the back room, and tell me want to hear the lyrics that I got. So I start singing Praise You, Jaja, and he say, yeah, that's the first song I really write, you know. And he said, yeah, I like that. So tell you what you do, check me tomorrow. So I check him at his yard, and it starts from there.
Yeah,
you know. So then
he gave you the name.
Yeah, he gave me the name Michael Prophet, because what he did when I start, because I write my own lyrics and all them things, but what he did to help me at the moment was to let me do the Eptones song Fight It to the Top, to like promotion wise, and it did kick off.
Was that the first one that was released?
That the first one released, really, and it did kick off. It gave me a boost, you know, and that's where we take off from, really.
I'm
How popular were these tunes then in Jamaica, these first?
Very popular. Very popular because I was even on Where It's At. You know, they got the television thing, and like every Friday and thing, you know, different artists go up and things. So I was there, and that's the reason why I know it was a very popular song. Even until now. If I touch that tune on stage, man, the place God, that was the first one fighting to the top. Yeah.
Yeah. You recorded a number of albums with Yabu, and you know, and of course they're still selling today. You know, with tracks like Gates of Zion, You know, what inspired you to write these songs?
Well, it's due to where I grow up. Yeah. In the ghetto, you know what I'm saying? You know, when you come from the ghetto, man, it's like, boy, it's either a hider, it's either you try to live or you die. You know what I'm saying? Because it's really rough there. Yeah. So I think that what inspired me is all the struggle, you see? And I really take it serious and put it to use, like put it to lyrics, you know, lyrical and, you know, inspiration-wise from Jah. The Almighty, He inspired me, so that's where it really comes, you know.
Yeah.
He encouraged me to go take it deeply.
Yeah. I read in an interview that even though the recordings you made your name, you know you become in the big league. Then,
yeah.
But you didn't receive much.
I didn't. And even until now, you see. I've even received what I'm supposed to receive, but I'm still going on. I ain't worrying about it. You know what I'm saying? Because that's what they do to manipulate artists. You know, yeah. You know what I'm saying? Try to keep. They know you're good, and it's like they're afraid to tell you, listen, man, you're good, and you know, let's get it on.
Yeah.
They try to manipulate you, bring you down, and all them things. You know, so that's the reason why I didn't even break away from YBU and few different producers, really.
Yeah, because of that.
My brother, listen carefully. For every mentor, this is a day. Yes, my heart is in the day. I do good matter. Gates of Zion, it's a big hope. For each and everyone to step right in. The worry of the wicked is that you don't. For anywhere you go,
And after you stopped working with Yabba Hugh at that time, you did a tune for Freedom Sounds, didn't you?
Yeah, Poverty. So yeah,
tell me about
how
that came about.
At that time, when I do Poverty, right, I was really going through stress, despair. It's like, boy, the struggle I was going through, what I was facing is like, boy. You know, it's like everyone have their own tribulation, right? But and every man think their burden is the heaviest. Bob said that, you know what I'm saying? And eventually one day, Mr. Brown, he come to me and he said, well, boy, Prophet, I want you to do this for me. And I said, boy, this is the right lyrics, man. And when I heard the song, and I said, boy, it couldn't be nothing better than Poverty, you know what I'm saying? Because we all going through it, you know what I'm saying? We're facing it, you know? So from the struggle, you know, that's how Poverty really comes along, because I was going through a lot of stress and, you know what I'm saying, as a youth coming up, you know. But, boy, right now I'm feeling real great. I'm proud of it, you know. I didn't put myself to waste as what they maybe were thinking at the time. Because, you see, when you're young, like, a lot of things hit you, yeah? A lot of things come, a lot of things go, and, you know, they might think, boy, you know, he ain't gonna live out his days, man, to achieve what's happening down there. You know what I'm saying? So let's just take what he give us and that's it.
Yeah.
You know, but I think they got it all wrong. You know, right now, a lot of the producers, they got the things all wrong, you know? Because I know I could be better, I could be bigger, and I'm thankful for what's happening right now. I can't say anything. I just have to see it and watch it. And
because there's not really that many singers who have been in the business for 10 years, 12 years, like you have, who are still there, you know, and still charting.
Yeah, I give God Oh, man.
Have you ever take a little trip into the ghetto? When the rain it falls, it comes to my roof and my window. Yes, release the shackle of my hands, release the chain of my feet. For all I ever see is just poverty. Poverty's the biggest crime in this time. You're right, so I've got to tell you everything I've got on my mind. Yes, poverty's the biggest crime in this time. All I see is all the time.
Commercial peak once you hooked up with Junjo.
Yeah.
In the early 80s.
Yeah.
Did you go to Junjo because you were dissatisfied with things that were going elsewhere? Finally hooked up with them that way.
The thing is, when you're that Jamaica right, as an artist, and once you get something out there and you're carrying a name, you find that a lot of producers really want a bit of you, a piece of you and thing, yeah? And at the moment, what was going on, Junjo was shocking out. Volcano Label was really taking the place by storm.
Barrington Levy,
Linville Thompson, Yellowman, me, Johnny Osborne, you name them, right? And it's like, to the area where we live in, it's like, I can just walk from my yard to Oakland Road and Junja and the Posse, you know, always out there, yeah. So. With little John Lola, we Italian and all of us, yeah? And it's like, after doing a few songs like For Yabby and Walk Away and thing, he really want to see me, he really want to get things done. So it's like the day when I got there, that was it. He just said, boy, Prophet, a human want. It's like, you know, he feel happy when he see me. He said, boy, you I want you now. And we gone a studio the next day. And do the album, Righteous of the Conqueror. And then we kind of start moving, you know, further. Then I do the Michael Prophet album, like with Gunman, and them tune Upside Down.
Because Gunman's probably your biggest hit, I think, he's had, is that right?
I really think so.
Was that a controversial tune to do at the time, with all the sort of election
violence? Yeah, that tune have a lot to do with the election, really, because... It wasn't lovely, you know, when politics time come and there's a lot of things happening, gun firing, people, you know, getting shot and all them things, you know, and where you live, boy, it's just a havoc, you know, so virtually that's where, you know, that's what inspired me from all them things to do it, like gun
fight because of that?
No, I think after I do that song, right, I was pretty well brave to do that.
It maybe struck a chord.
Yeah, because I could, like, for the years go by, and thing, I find, like, even less guns start to fire, and, you know, people, they do enjoy the lyrics because it's positive, you know what I'm saying? And That tune did really do a lot towards politics, kind of cool it down, because they were saying, boy, well, you know, here's someone telling it.
Yeah.
Straightforward, you know.
Yeah.
This is what guns is all about.
Shout out, we all are revealed. He was. It was the city of my life. Really open my eyes that I can see what is over me. It was the city of my life. Really open my eyes and save me. From gunmen standing over me with their guns and their bayonets, me cry, oh, oh, people are gonna feel it. Me shout, oh, oh, the Allah reveal it. Boy, 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 boy. It was the savior of my life. He opened my eyes and saved me. Oh Lord, from gunmen standing over me with their guns and their bayonets. Me cry, oh, oh, people are gonna feel it. Me shout, oh, oh, the Allah reveal it. Boy, boy, boy. Boy, boy, boy. Because the world is confused, they don't know what to do. Listen to me, what I say to you. The people is confused, they don't know who to choose. Even if they listen to the headline news, it's gunman standing over me with their guns and their bayonets. They cry, oh, oh, people are gonna feel it. They shout, oh, oh, the Allah reveal it. Boy, he was.
Why did you stop working with John Joe? Yeah.
Well, due to the year goes by and thing, I found, like, you know, what I was expecting to achieve from John Joe towards my career and all them things, I wasn't getting it. Mm. Because at the moment, you have too much artists to penetrate. And so you can't have, like, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 artists, which is good, mm-hmm. in one stable, because you don't know who to really penetrate. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Maybe I could be the right one to penetrate. There comes Barrington Levy, could be Barrington Levy, could be Yellow Man. And eventually, it worked out that he penetrate Yellow Man away from even me and Barrington Levy, who even give him the biggest hits.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Because right now, in the Jungle's stable, Gunman is biggest hit, his bestseller, and I didn't get. I'm ashamed to even mention certain things, you know. I didn't get nothing. They deprived me, and I couldn't take that.
Yeah, because you started to produce yourself.
Yeah,
you did that album,
Love Is an Earth.
Yeah, did you then decide, well, you're better off working for yourself?
Yeah, and then when I start off for myself, I find it's a bit hard again because, boy, it's like you have to give people a blight sometime, and it's like for that, it's like I wouldn't get no buy, you know. So after that, I just said, well, then, boy, let me turn it around again, and you know what I'm saying? So I start off, what did I do after Love Is That Other Thing? I did this album, Bloodstain, again.
That's for Live and Learn. Live and Learn,
right? And then it was the same situation. And it's like, I couldn't really take the agony and out going out there and in there, out there, in there, out there. It's a lot of headache.
Yeah.
So what I do, I just decided to cool out a bit. You know what I'm saying? Cool out a bit because, boy, I know I'm good, you know what I'm saying? And instead of sing yourself out for nothing, it's best to just sit and hold it and write my lyrics.
Because in the mid-80s was a time when you probably had the least success after the early days.
Yeah.
How did you feel when there was people coming along like Sammy Levi, Sammy Drake, Carl Meeks, who were directly imitating?
Yeah, well, let me tell you all about them. Carl Meeks, Sammy Levi, Sammy Dread, Sea and Success.
Yeah.
What's his name? Courtney Melody. Well, in Pinchers, right? I'm their coach.
Yeah.
Right? And the only one who ever really look at me and tell me, boy, I respect for what you've done, you know, is Carl Meeks. All the others just feel like, so well, and yeah, Michael Prophet lined me up and me gone, so they didn't come back and say, boy, well done, Michael. You know what I'm saying? And I don't feel any way about it. I don't feel, you know, I'm the original. Yeah. And nothing beats the original.
I noticed on the new album, the track Tickle Me, is where you actually like doing a Carl Meeks style there on the vocal, even though you were the original from way back.
Yeah.
It's like the Carl Meeks bit that he does, and it's...
Yeah, well, you know, I'm the original Sing J rapper. And sometimes I can't leave that out. I have to be there, you know. I have to show them that, listen, man, I'm versatile, you know, and that's what it's all about. That's what I'm here to do, you know. I'm very versatile, so like, they didn't worry me, you know. I because what due to Caesar you give to Caesar, man. I admire their singing, man, you know. Well respected by I, man, as I know they respect me. So respect you, you know what I'm saying. I'm feeling proud for what I've done to help them to realize what this is all about.
I mean, the interesting thing is, like, some of those guys who had big success, like Carl Meeks and Courtney Melody, who, you know, used your style, is that right now as we speak in 93, them guys really aren't there.
No.
Forefront, but you're still...
As I say, nothing beat the original, you know what I'm saying? The original is always there because I've been in for 15 years and... I enjoy singing. That's my main, this is my main ability, singing. I enjoy doing it. Yeah? And there's nothing can put me away, put me down, you know. My career is what I really admire and I love it.
Yeah.
Yeah? That's how it goes.
Fall in love again, no, 'cause you get.
work was surprised in the 80s, you know, you built your reputation on being a conscious artist,
right.
Conscious vocalist.
Right.
And in the mid-80s you were coming with tracks like Touch Me Back, Fallen Soul.
Yeah, you see,
why did you...
As time goes by, the dancehall changes, you know, so you have to change with the system, yeah? You can't just one stagnant, like, you know, one all along, you just stagnant, the one thing going on. You have to switch. And, yeah, we ride with the time.
Yeah.
You see, because if you don't ride with the time, you're going to get left out. You know what I'm saying? But at the time when I do all them tunes, I didn't feel real pleased, like, yeah, that was Michael Prophet, but I just have to do it. You know, this is what the voice
just
is all about. Yeah, keep my name going. This is what it's all about. You see? And that was for Powerhouse, because Touch My Back, and it was this song, Harlem Pool, yeah, on the Powerhouse label, George Fung. Yeah. And all them songs I've done, I don't get nothing.
Yeah.
All I get is just the fame.
Praise
without praise. And boy, right now, those producers, I don't know. You see, I don't know if they could really face me and sit down and have a good conversation with me about the past, really, because now I'm a different man. You know what I'm saying? It's not like the Michael Prophet they know when I was in Jamaica. I come here and I make
you
myself.
Now and
yeah, and I know the business now, and you know they have to talk to me good and proper.
Is there any producers that you've worked with in the past who still have a good relationship with, or are you one of the artists you know,
has
you seen that, well, all producers are vampires?
Yeah, to be frank, right, all of them is bloodsuckers, man, and I'm in a partial, right, because I've been through a lot of them, and you know what I'm saying, and I've seen a lot of artists being get left out by the same thing. They even give up hopes, and so then why am I stop singing? Because he get rubbed off maybe a album or a song or something, he just stops singing and just hang his career up, hang his gloves up. Well, I didn't. I get rubbed, you know, and then I feel the pain, and then I start all over again, and I will continue to do that. So, you know, a man can't rub this. He can't take this away from me. Yeah?
There's a lot of talk right now about the state of reggae music generally, you know, about gunman lyrics, gun talk and slackness and stuff like that. How do you feel about the music going in that direction when you came through, you know, it was all sort of conscious lyrics?
Yeah,
and stuff like that.
In the 80s, to me it was like better days. People were more serious, more conscious within the whole situation, the whole universe, like it was booming, conscious. You know, there wasn't no DJ to tell you about On The Girl and all them things, you see, because all them time with Uri, Scotty and Big Youth and all them man was just some conscious lyrics, Trinity and thing, you know? And it just changed. As I said, time do change, and you find the younger youth, them the younger generation, they come up, man, anything goes, you know what I'm saying? Because it's, they might talking about the woman, but still the girls are going out to buy the music.
Yeah.
And they are the same one kicking up rumpus in the dance hall. When they hear it, they, you know? So, I ain't got nothing to say about it, man. You know what I mean? What a man does, it's just what he does, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You know, I ain't got nothing to say it towards artists, because they have to live. We have to live, we have to eat.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? But I know what I do. You know what I'm saying?
You wouldn't do that sort of
thing. Nah, I wouldn't go out there and sing about a girl and sing about underneath her, man. I come from woman, man. My mom, man. I've got sisters. And a lot of the DJ, they really disrespect women anyway, but
do you find it's harder for you to come through as an artist these days, because like a lot of youth just really want that, you know, that type of slackness lyrics?
No, I don't find it real hard. I don't find it hard, but I'm just biding my time. I'm just biding my time, because I know, boy, they come now and tomorrow they're gone. And I'll be standing here like a brick wall. You know what I'm saying?